this morning I'm very excited. We have Dr. Mark VanGessel all the way from Delaware. So he was here last year and graciously accepted an invitation to come back. He does a really good job, and he's going to give us an update on weed and herbicide control and some other research that he's been doing. So Mark, thanks for coming. We appreciate it very much.
So thank you. Thank you for the invitation. I always enjoy coming over. This is a great meeting. Looking around the crowd, I see I'm not the only one from Delaware making the long trip over here to Queens Anne County. But Jenny asked me to come over and talk about, just kind of give a general herbicide update. I want to talk about some of the work that we've been doing. You know, and whenever I share our work at the University of Delaware, I got to acknowledge the group that I work with, Barb Scott, Quentin Johnson, and Kurt Vollmer, who all work on weed management with me. I also need to acknowledge the folks I work with up at Penn State quite a bit, Bill Curran, Dwight Lingenfelter, and John Wallace, for some of the information they've shared over the years with us, and some of the projects that we do jointly with Penn State. So here's some of the things I want to talk about. I'm going to talk a little bit about dicamba-resistant soybeans, talk a little bit about resistance management. Then I want to focus on management of three herbicide-resistant weeds and some of the issues we have with these particular species. There's been a publication that Ron Ritter started, probably Jim Parachetti before Ron, on weed management in Maryland. And it has been a collaborative effort with other weed science programs in the Mid-Atlantic region, although each state kind of had their own different form of it. So in 2016, Burkhardt Schultz from Maryland, myself, the folks at Penn State, Virginia Tech got together and say, let's just put our efforts into one publication. And we came up with a publication named the Mid-Atlantic Weed Management Guide. It's much of the same information that was available in EB 237 or the publication that Ron did for a number of years. But it's updated, it's been expanded to cover cover crops, management of cover crops and burn down. It covers corn, soybeans, small grains, milo, and forages. It's quite comprehensive. It's available online. You can order it online through Penn State. Jenny, do you have any in your office?
I do. If anybody wants them, they can give me a call.
So Jenny has some here in Kent County, I think, Queens Anne, I think Jimmy. I think some of the counties have them as well. So
Kent County's
got them as well. So you can get them at the county office or you can order it online. If you're ordering it online, if you just Google the Mid-Atlantic Weed Management Guide or AGRS 136, and you can purchase it and they'll ship it down to you. There's also available through, I know at least through my website, University of Delaware, we have a free version. It's a low resolution. And when you say low resolution, it is very poor quality, but it is a free version if that's what you need. Okay, I'm going to talk a little bit about dicamba-resistant soybeans. It's one of those topics that a lot of people are interested in. I wanted to address it and kind of give some of my thoughts about it and provide a little bit of guidance on it. And part of it is maybe a word of caution with this. You know, while we've had dicamba for 50, 60 years, we really haven't been using it in the last few years, in the last 15, 20 years, like we could be coming forward. And by that I mean a lot of the dicamba applications have been as tank mix partners with other products. Now, with the dicamba-resistant soybeans, we have the opportunity to really lean on dicamba for weed control. So we're going to be using dicamba at much higher rates than we used to be using, than we're used to using. And that adds a level of concern with this technology. So I think we need to be cautious about it. As you know, the soybeans, the genetics are labeled. The EPA has registered some formulations of dicamba for this over-the-top application. The labels are fairly restrictive, and they are expanding to allow more use, particularly in terms of the nozzles you can select and the tank mix partners that are allowed. But as of right now, they are fairly limited. In fact, as of today, you cannot use these dicamba formulations in combination with glyphosate. The label doesn't allow that tank mix. We certainly hope that that changes before the use season, but as of now, that's the way the labels are written. There's three major companies right now are involved in this. The Extended Max from Monsanto, Ingenia from BASF, and DuPont has their version, Fexapan. As tank mixes are allowed, as adjuvants are allowed, as tips are allowed, they're updating it on the website. And so each company has their own website to alert growers and applicators of what is the most current labels and the most current options for use. There's the Ingenia Tank Mix, the Extendamax, and DuPont. And why DuPont didn't come up with none of these names are really short and catchy, but this one, no one's gonna memorize that one. But if you just Google the DuPont dicamba soybeans, it'll come up. But keep up with, if you're interested in using this technology, keep up with these websites as the changes are made and things are being expanded. Why the concern about dicamba? I know a lot of my colleagues in their talks and presentations, companies, dealers are all, there's a heightened awareness about this and somewhat of a concern. And part of it is dicamba, like other products, but dicamba in particular, can cause injury at very low rates. This is a trial that was done at University of Arkansas where they were applying dicamba at various rates over non-dicamba resistant soybeans. Then they made these applications at the R1 stage, which is the most critical stage in terms of when the soybeans are most susceptible. But they sprayed dicamba at the full rate, sprayed at a quarter rate, 1/16th, they all went all the way out to this 1/1024. This is a researcher who's doing this. Why they just didn't do it at 1/1000th and make it a lot easier on everybody, I don't know. But there must have been some logic there. But the point is they use some really low rates. And even at this really low rate, they're getting a 10% yield loss when dicamba is sprayed to soybeans at the R1 stage. To kind of put that in perspective, if you think of a spray tank that's 1,000 gallons, the applicator is applying it at 15 gallons to the acre, the dicamba formulation is 16 fluid ounces, that's a pint, so they're covering 67 acres with this 1,000 gallon tank. So they're putting about 1,072 fluid ounces in that 1,000 gallon tank. What that comes out to is that rate that's causing the 10% yield loss is about 1 fluid ounces per 1,000 gallon tank. So we're talking really low amounts that can cause injury. That's where the concern is. That's why we have the concern. Whether it's direct application because of a contamination like this, or whether it's due to drift and volatility moving from the intended target to susceptible crops. As air temperature increases, the potential for droplets for individual droplets to lose volume increases. And as we get smaller and smaller droplets, we get the greater and greater chance for risk, for off-target movement. As a result, these products require the use of extra coarse or ultra coarse droplets, very large droplets, so to minimize the amount of or the potential for off-target movement. While these droplets, while these nozzles do create a number of large droplets, there still are some fines or small droplets still in that coming out of that nozzle, We don't eliminate fines. We just reduce the number of very fine droplets. Why do we bring this up? You know, who's going to, you know, just want to alert that this is a something that everyone is aware of, whether you're in the ag community or not. And there's going to be a lot of, particularly the first couple of years, of looking at how well does this stuff stay in place and being on the lookout, you know, kind of a heightened awareness when injury does occur. You know, if someone's got some soybeans like this, or whether it's a soybean plant or a tomato in a garden or an oak tree, you see a little bit of a crinkling, you know, who's going to get blamed for that that injury? Is it going to be the next door neighbor that's using a handheld boom and dousing the dandelions? Is it going to be the commercial applicator down the road? So think about that as you try to decide whether this is a product you want to use. Using dicamba-resistant soybeans, the number one message, be a good neighbor. This stuff can move. While there's a lot, the research is showing that the potential for off-target movement is reduced dramatically, it hasn't been eliminated. And a lot of this hasn't really been vetted as well, as it, in my opinion, as it needs to be. Originally, this sort of technology was going to be made available in the Midwest in a few select counties. They were going to make it available there for a year or two and kind of learn its strengths and weaknesses and develop a good stewardship program and move out from there. But because this technology has been held up, they're making it available nationwide all in the first year, and we don't have the luxury of learning from other people's experience. So be a good neighbor if you're thinking about using this as a technology. Is it gonna, and you know, why do we wanna, why are people excited about this? You know, one, it's new, but really we gotta sit back and ask yourself, what's it gonna bring that we currently don't have? You know, looking at publications that what we have in our Mid-Atlantic guide down at North Carolina State, Ohio, Purdue, Arkansas, Mississippi, Tennessee, looked at a number of publications and wanted to see where dicamba is doing better than either Reflex or Liberty, two current options that are working well for us in the Mid-Atlantic state. Well, for horse weed control, where, and I must admit that not every publication rated all these weeds, but with horse weed, three of the publications rated dicamba, along with Reflex, along with Liberty to compare. And one out of three had a higher rating for dicamba compared to these other two. Palmer, same ratio, 2 out of 6. For common ragweed, 1 out of 4 rated dicamba better than these current options. So the point is, we currently do have good options for control of some of these problem weeds. We just need to make sure that we use these options in an effective manner. Currently, the extended max, and this is the Monsanto version, is limited to 6 tank mixes. And these just came out last week. So these things are starting to change, and they're going to be updated. But as of right now, there's 6 currently tank mixes. Unfortunately, none of them are glyphosate at this point. They've approved about 20 different nozzles that can be used. These are all nozzles that would produce extra coarse or ultra coarse droplets. They limit the number of adjuvants that can be used, but currently there's up to about 20 different adjuvants. And so refer to the websites, as I mentioned, as these updates become available. They don't allow the use of ammonium sulfate. You cannot use ammonium sulfate with this. And the reason for that is acidic solution will cause dicamba to disassociate from its salt form to an acid. And the acid is what is volatile and has the potential to move off target. So the concern with all these tank mixes is that it doesn't affect the pH of the solution. And ammonium sulfate is one of those that will reduce the solution pH. So no ammonium sulfate is allowed. Tractor speed is no more than 15 miles per hour. Boom height, no more than 24 inches. They have do not apply if rain is expected either in 24 for the extended max or 4 hours for Ingenia. Triple rinse, and I think this is going to be one of our challenges in the area is making sure that we rinse our tanks out. I know there's a lot of talk about volatility and off-target movement. I think tank rinse is going to be a bigger challenge for us. This is not a step that you can take lightly or scrimp on. And the labels require report of non-performance. What is new about these formulations? You know, we've had dicamba registered for corn and small grains for a long time. Is that these, they're lower volatility formulations. The extended max, which and also the DuPont version, it's a diglycolamine salt. That's the same salt that's been used in some of the other formulations, but it has a drift reducer. That's what they call their vapor grip. So it's a different formulation with additives that help to reduce drift potential. Ingenia, the BASF version, they have come up with a different salt that reduces drift and off-target movement. One of the things about this, as I look at a lot of the sales information on this, is they tout this long window of application from pre-emergence up through R1 or flowering stage. It's nice flexibility from that standpoint, but I think what gets lost in that message is the timing of application needs to be based on weed size. The labels say spray at weeds to 4 inches or less. So this is not the type of rescue treatment where we're going to be able to successfully go in and control palmer that's 20 inches tall. We're not going to be able to control mare's tail that's tall either. This is still a product that needs to be applied to small susceptible plants. This is the part on the label that's probably the most difficult to interpret. It's the buffer areas. They require a buffer of 110 feet downwind if you're applying half a pound acid equivalent, or 220 feet if that's a pound acid equivalent. The two formulations between BASF and Monsanto are not the same concentration. One, I think the rate is 16 fluid ounces, the other is 22. The labels are very, very similar, but they're not identical. So you gotta make sure you read the label of the product you wanna use and make sure you're following it to the T. The labels talk about sensitive areas and they talk about non-target susceptible crops. Sensitive areas, it's kind of hard to interpret what it means. This is my own interpretation. Sensitive areas, anything that contains a broadleaf plant. And if you don't own it, it's a sensitive area. They also talk about non-target susceptible crops. So, sensitive areas, the downwind, if the wind is blowing towards a sensitive area, and you're using, with the Monsanto version, the 22 fluid ounces, you need 110 feet of that buffer area between your application area and your sensitive area. If your field butts up right next to a sensitive area, that means you need to lay off 110 feet from that edge. You can't spray right up to the edge. So then you're going to have to go back and treat this edge differently than the rest of the field. If you're using higher than the 22 fluid ounces, which is allowed for burn down, that expands from 110 feet to 220 feet. If the wind is 10 to 15 miles an hour blowing towards a sensitive area, the label doesn't allow you to spray if it's blowing towards a sensitive area. The non-target susceptible crops, here's a list of what they refer to them. This is a combination of the different labels. It includes commercially grown tomatoes, fruiting vegetables, cucurbits, peas, shade houses, grapes, ornamentals. So it's a pretty extensive list. So the wind restrictions are, if it's less than 3 miles an hour, one of them says if it's less than 3 miles an hour, don't use it. The other one says if it's less than 3 miles an hour, ensure that no temperature inversion is occurring. So a temperature inversion is where typically the air is warmer next to the ground and it gets cooler as you get higher. A temperature inversion is just the opposite, where it's cooler near the ground and it warms as you move higher. Heard a lot about the off-target movement out in Missouri and Tennessee. Talking to the folks that were out there, they suspect that a lot of that had to do with temperature inversions occurring. And I was asking them about, you know, what defines a temperature inversion? How high are you measuring your temperatures? And it's only a matter of a few degrees difference. And they're working with the climatologists out in their respective states. And they're measuring temperature at about 2 feet and 6 feet. And if there's and if it's warmer, 6 feet off the ground, than it is 2 feet off the ground, they're in a temperature inversion. So there can be some fairly subtle changes in temperature that can create these temperature inversions, which is very still air and allows these droplets to stay suspended for a long period of time. And because there's no wind, it's hard to say where those droplets are moving to. That's the concern with the temperature inversions. Spraying in wind speeds of 3 to 10 miles per hour is optimum. If it's 10 to 15 miles an hour, don't spray if the wind is moving towards neighboring sensitive crops, is the way some of the labels refer to it. If the wind is more than 15 miles an hour, don't apply. Triple rinse, as I mentioned, is going to be critical. As you remember from that example, 1 ounce in a 1,000-gallon tank was capable of causing 10% soybean loss. So, and that 1 ounce can hide anywhere in the spray tank and in the booms. So, determine if what you, make sure your expectations of what dicamba will do for you meets what your goals are. Make sure that the benefits outweigh the restrictions. Again, be a good neighbor. If you want to try this, I recommend you read the label twice and then read it and a third time. The label is written so whoever makes that application is responsible for it. So don't rely on someone else telling you that it's okay to do this. You've got to read it, you've got to understand it, and you've got to be comfortable with it. If you want to try it, I say, you know, particularly in Delaware where we have a lot of vegetables, but where don't we have lots of vegetables on the Eastern Shore? You know, maybe if you've been comfortable with 2,4-D in your burn down, this might be an opportunity to replace it and get some experience with it. Go slow. I think with time we'll develop more comfort and a better understanding of its strengths and weaknesses, and we'll start to understand where it has a better fit for us. But that's going to be time and experience in which, unfortunately, we don't have at this point. Spraying it after the soybeans are planted and the soybeans are up, we're talking about higher temperatures, so we increase that risk for off-target movement. It adds another level of caution. And certainly as we get into July with our double crop soybeans, it's even higher. So just be aware. Think about where you might want to try it and make sure it's a good situation for you. Any questions about dicamba and dicamba soybeans? Otherwise, I'm going to move on a little bit. Okay. We talked a little bit about resistance. Probably certainly not a new topic to any of us. But it is something that we need to be well aware of and needs to be not just in the back of our mind, but in our forefront as we start looking at our weed management programs. We've heard a lot about herbicide group numbers. products that are single active ingredients like Sandia that only have a single group number. Other products that might have multiple herbicides in the same container has multiple group numbers. And I think, you know, we've been encouraging folks to use multiple modes of action. I think we need to be keep in mind that it's not just multiple modes of action or sites of action, but it's effective sites of action as well. Just because you're using a product that has two or three active ingredients in it, all with a different site of action, doesn't necessarily mean that that's an effective resistance management program. Here's an example. Someone's looking through one of the guides or publications and looking at something that they might be able to use post-emergence on this combination of weeds, the Palmer amaranth, common lamb's quarter, common ragweed, and giant foxtail. There's a product that's called Revlon Q, and they look at it and say, well, gosh, it's got an 8 plus out of 10. That's a high number. 9, 8, and 9. So looks pretty good, you know, across this range of spectrum. It's got both a group 2 and a group 27 herbicide, two different mechanisms of action. You know, it might be set up pretty well for resistance management. But if you look at what is Revlon Q? It's a prepackaged mix of Accent and Callisto. And rather than looking at the combination, you got to think about what are the components of that. So with Accent, or with Giant Foxtail, the Accent portion has given us 9 out of 10, a really high rating. It's a very effective herbicide on Giant Foxtail. But the Callisto has given us almost no control. So the only site of action that's really affecting Giant Foxtail is the Callisto. May not be of concern. Giant Foxtail is not one of those species that tends to show a lot of resistance. Common ragweed, lamb's quarter, both of them, based on regional ratings and stuff, the Nicosulfuron or the Accent component, it's given us about a 6, so it's given us a little bit of suppression, but it's the Callisto that's bringing us the control. And while the Callisto is quite effective on both of these, we're only getting effective control out of one of those active ingredients. Palmer amaranth. You know, Accent is good on Palmer amaranth as long as it's the Palmer amaranth is susceptible to Accent or to group 2 herbicides. And unfortunately, most of the Palmer amaranth we have in our area is not susceptible to group 2 herbicides, resistant to group 2 herbicides. So really, we're getting no activity out of Accent on our Palmer amaranth for the bulk of our plants in the area. Callisto, on the other hand, is giving us 8.5, so we're getting good activity out of it. So while Palmer amaranth is one of those that we're very concerned about for resistance, and we say using multiple sites of action, we really mean effective sites of action, we don't have two good sites of action for control of Palmer amaranth in this tank mix. We've only got one. So when you see these multiple modes of action, you know, it requires digging a little bit deeper sometimes to find out that they're both or there's more than one effective sites of action on those problem weeds. Unfortunately, you know, we don't have a single go-to guide to provide this information. Some of the resources that's out there is this Mid-Atlantic Field Crop Guide, which is very good for doing this. And another guide that is very helpful for this is this Take Action Guide from USB. And Jenny says you're all getting one today. Get them on the back table. It's a nice colorful guide that lists all the different herbicide mechanisms and sites of action that are commonly used in the area. But it also, on the right-hand side, lists all the common premixes. So the products like Harness. What's Harness Extra? What's in Harness Extra? Well, it's listed here. What's in Resicor? We've got the combinations of Resicor listed in this table. So it's a useful table to help identify what are the constituents in these premixes. Okay? can identify this weed. Anybody seen this one? Palmer amaranth. So obviously from the no response, it means you don't have any Palmer amaranth in Queen Anne's County. Is that right, Jenny?
Okay.
Two weeds. She's only got two weeds. That's right. You don't need many to start. Palmer amaranth is rampant in parts of the Eastern Shore. Some of the fields are just overrun with Palmer amaranth, and it starts from having one or two plants that goes to seed. It produces a tremendous number of seeds, and it's a very aggressive plant that can take over a field very, very quickly. It's a summer annual. It has the potential to germinate throughout the summer. I half jokingly say it will germinate from frost to frost. Palmer amaranth in and of itself, it's a very difficult to control weed because it grows so fast, it's very aggressive. However, you add on top of the fact that most of what we have in the region is resistant to group 2 and group 9 herbicides, or it's resistant to glyphosate and all the ALS inhibiting herbicides. So, and the big concern, the another level of concern, is that there's resistance to other herbicides in other regions of the U.S. It's one of these species that's very prone to developing resistance. It spreads very rapidly with equipment, and because it grows very fast, there are no rescue treatments out there. It gets more than 6 inches tall. It is very tough to control, and there's not many. If you're able to consistently, you're not going to be able to consistently control 6 inch tall. You're lucky if you're controlling 6 inch tall Palmer amaranth. That's the problem. It's got to be sprayed while it's small. We can manage it. We've talked about this, a lot. I think in some cases we've given people the impression that you can't manage this species. It's out of control. There's nothing we can do about it. And that's not the case. We do have options that we can control it, but it has to be done in a timely fashion. Timing is very important with it. We recommend that residual herbicides be applied at planting. And the emphasis here is at planting, not 2-4 weeks before planting, but those residuals be applied at planting to give us 3 to 4 weeks of residual control and allows us to make timely post-emergence applications. And because it continues to germinate throughout the summer, we almost always are going to need a post-emergent spray with it. These residuals, as I said, will bring us about 4 weeks of residual control. And as a result, we recommend that these post-emergence applications are made about 4 weeks after the pre's were applied. We consistently go out with our treatments on our trials over at the Research and Education Center and on-farm, with our post-emergence applications being made 4 weeks after the pre. And those post-herbicides include a residual herbicide with them, and we consistently get good control. Those residual herbicides carry us up through canopy closure, and Palmer amaranth doesn't come up in the shade. What are we talking about for residual control? For corn, we're looking at using like a chlorocetamide plus an atrazine. So like Bicep, Harness, Anthem, or Zidua plus atrazine. And then the post-emergence application of usually of glyphosate for others, and then Callisto plus a low rate of atrazine. Notice that in these fields with heavy Palmer amaranth, we do know we have to come back post-emergence with something other than glyphosate, and that's where this Callisto falls in. So, if you're coming back post-emergence, you know you have to come back post-emergence to control it, and you're using Callisto. We're avoiding using pre-emergence herbicides that have the same mechanism of action as Callisto. Things like Lumax, Lexar, Resicor, Acuron, they all contain the same mechanism of action as Callisto. Why put additional selection pressure on these plants by using it repeatedly when If we're using a good solid base treatment of these clarosetamide plus azatrazine, and we know we're going to come back with Callisto, save that use of that HPPD herbicide till it's post-emergence. And that post-emergence application, as I said, about 4 weeks after the pre's have been applied. Another option that works well, particularly in no-till, is atrazine or simazine plus one of these clarosetamides up front before planting, and then an early post-emergence application of Halix GT plus atrazine. That also has worked well for us. Soybeans are a little bit more challenging, primarily because we don't have as good of products post-emergence, or our selection of post-emergence products are limited. We like to start with a pre-herbicide of metribuzin, flumioxazin, sulfentrazone, or a chlorosetamide, a combination of two of these four. One of the standards we've been using is Valor plus metribuzin. Canopy fits in there. Authority MTZ. There's others as well, but the key is using a pre-herbicide and then needing to come back post-emergence in a timely fashion. Four, because so much of our Palmer amaranth is resistant to the ALS inhibiting herbicides, things like Classic and Synchrony and Pursuit don't work on it. What we have found to be the most consistent has been using glyphosate for everything else and then coming back with this Fomosafen or Reflex as a post-emergent spray. We like to see the rate of Reflex at least one and a quarter pints, because we're relying on that Reflex to provide both post-emergence control of Palmer as well as providing residual activity. And it does provide good residual activity post-emergence. LibertyLink soybeans fit in nicely as well with Palmer amaranth. But Liberty does not provide any residual activity, so it's going to need another product to help with later emerging. Reflex would fit into that, or Dual is another option, particularly if you're in veggie rotations and you can't use the Reflex. Double crop soybeans can be challenging because a lot of the Palmer amaranth is already up at time of planting, and the glyphosate for burn down won't control it. We've had good success with using Liberty as part of that burn down. We've been using Liberty in combination with glyphosate for burn down. Does a nice job of controlling a broad spectrum of weeds, including the Palmer amaranth and mare's tail. And then a post-emergence application a number of options fit in there. Reflex, you know, if you're using Reflex post-emergence, double crop soybeans, you got to be careful about the cutoff date so that you can rotate back to vegetables or even corn the following year. Blazer Ultra is an option. And then with Liberty Link soybeans, Liberty is an option here. Sweet corn, I know there's some sweet corn growing up in this area. Because sweet corn, particularly early planted sweet corn, generally is harvested midsummer, a lot of times that's before Palmer amaranth has started to produce seed, that sometimes the need for post-emergent sprays isn't as critical with sweet corn, because we're harvesting the field and destroying the Palmer amaranth before the next crop comes in. Some of the options that we've got, Bicep, Lexar, particularly if we're in situations where we're going to be harvesting the sweet corn early, timely post, and then some of the post-emergence options in sweet corn. If we're in vegetable situations and we're worried about rotations, Impact or Armazon work well for controlling Palmer amaranth. Or if carryover and rotation isn't as big of an issue, Callisto fits into there as well. The next one I want to talk about is horseweed or mare's tail. It's one that we've been battling for a long time. It is a winter annual, but also germinates throughout the summer. it basically would germinate most months of the year. You know, I think the bulk of our Palmer or our mare's tail germinates in the fall, but we do get significant spring germination some years. It can be very difficult to control once the soybeans have emerged because we don't have a lot of good options for this post-emergence in soybeans. Most of our horseweed is resistant to glyphosate or group 9 herbicides, and I'm finding more and more of it's also resistant to group 2 herbicides or the ALS inhibiting herbicides. Corn, we don't seem to have many problems controlling this in corn. And I think a lot of it is because we're going out early in our no-till fields and controlling it with our burn down, often paraquat plus triazine or one of the triazines with glyphosate, and we're controlling it. The residuals that we're using in corn are controlling it. And then we, you know, whether we know it, realize it or not, a lot of our post-emergence products are controlling. So it's not, I seldom get called about it in corn. It's in soybeans that we have problems with mare's tail. Our best options, and I must admit, none of them are absolute. I wish we had a silver bullet, but probably our best options are 2,4-D, and that 2,4-D is at a quart rate. I get a lot of calls saying I used 2,4-D, I didn't control it. And I said, well, what rate of 2,4-D? I used a pint, and I used it 2 weeks before planting. Well, 2 weeks before planting soybeans, that mare's tail is probably 12 inches tall. You're not going to control it when it's 12 inches tall. You got to go out early and use that quart rate of 2,4-D. Or this is maybe where one of the areas of the dicamba soybeans will fit in, that dicamba. Or in situations where you have heavier soils, using Sharpen. And using Sharpen at least at 1.5 ounce seems to be more consistent, and making sure that Sharpen has a methylated seed oil with it. For burn down in double crop soybeans, as I mentioned, Liberty works pretty well for us. Residual herbicides that will control mare's tail that comes up after the burn down, things like metribuzin, sulfentrazone, or flumioxazin. So authority products or valor products. The post, as I mentioned, we don't have a lot of good options, particularly since a lot of it is ALS resistant, so it means Synchrony and First Rate often won't control it. Glyphosate, it's resistant to glyphosate. So the only good consistent treatment we have is using Liberty Link soybeans and spraying Liberty over the top. In situations where we have glyphosate resistant soybeans, a lot of times glyphosate is what I recommend. I know it doesn't make sense, but at least the glyphosate stunts it. And a lot of times that may give the soybeans a chance to overtop that mare's tail and shade it out. Small grains for control of mare's tail, because Harmony Extra is not working on some of these populations. Two products that have looked good in our trials are Husky and Culex or Quelex. These are two relatively new products for small grains. Be aware that they do have rotational considerations going to soybeans. I think they're 3 to 4 months rotating to soybeans. The last one I wanted to talk about species-wise was this common ragweed. I got a phone call about a couple of fields 2 years ago where common ragweed just didn't seem to die with their normal programs. So we collected seeds from over here on the eastern shore of Maryland, a little bit further south of here. not Queens Anne County. We collected from a couple of fields in Delaware, and I got some from New Jersey as well. So we went in and we tested it for whether it was resistant to glyphosate or Roundup, to Reflex, or to First Rate. All three of those products are usually very good on small common ragweed. Well, we had a few plants that survived when we applied those different treatments to it. So we took those plants that survived and sprayed them again with a three-way combination of glyphosate, Reflex, and First Rate, all in the same container at a 2x rate. And here are some of the plants that are still surviving those applications. So we have populations on the Eastern Shore and as well as up in New Jersey that are resistant to reflex, glyphosate, thank you, first rate. I can't remember which the last one I missed there. Now, of those fields, there were still, most of them, reflex still worked on it, but there were two fields that were resistant to all three of those products. So resistant to common ragweed is starting to show up, and it is something that we need to be aware of. Common ragweed's a summer annual. It emerges fairly early. It tends to not germinate as well once the soil temperatures start to warm up. We don't see as much germinating in early June as we do in early May. We have some that's resistant to all three of these, to glyphosate, ALS, and the PPO herbicides. More commonly, though, we have it's resistant to glyphosate and the ALS herbicides. It's only a few fields right now. It doesn't seem to be exploding and spreading very rapidly, but it is. It does have that chance to move around. Because it germinates so early in the year, we often are going to have plants that are emerged at time of burn down, particularly in soybeans. You know, so in soybeans, we did a trial down in on the Eastern Shore where we looked at a number of treatments, and the two products that look good for controlling at burn down, paraquat, and often paraquat with one of these triazines, whether it's atrazine or metribuzin, depending on which crop, and 2,4-D is part of the burn down controlled it. Pre-emergence control of common ragweed in corn, atrazine did a great job on it. Post-emergence, atrazine plus one of these HPPD herbicides, particularly like Callisto. I must say though, these HPPD herbicides by themselves are not very good on common ragweed, but tank mix with atrazine, it did a nice job with them. The dicamba products, whether it was status or Diflex or 2,4-D controlled it. Soybeans. The only three products that we found that consistently controlled it in soybeans were metribuzin, Command, and Lorox or Linex. How many of you remember that name? Yeah. It's amazing when you start pulling off the shelf when your common stuff doesn't work, you know? But yeah, Command and Lorox metribuzin were the three products that controlled these common ragweeds. Remember, any of the ALS herbicides or PPO herbicides like sulfentrazone or Authority or the Valor products didn't control the ragweed. Post-emergence, on this population that's resistant to first-rate glyphosate and PPOs, the only product we found that consistently controlled it was Liberty with Liberty Link soybeans. All right, I'm going to skip that. We just talked about three different weeds, and we talked about different strategies, options for controlling those. But what happens when you have more than one of them in the field at the same time? What happens if you've got mare's tail? So mare's tail, as I mentioned, it germinates usually in the fall. We get the bulk of it in the fall, all the way up till it really gets cold into November. And then it starts germinating again in the spring. So it has a pretty long germination period. Palmer amaranth, on the other hand, starts germinating in early April, and it can continue to germinate throughout the summer, and it starts to peter off as we get closer and closer to frost. And common ragweed, on the other hand, which tends to have a more confined germination period early in the spring. So you've got a field with all three of those weeds, and you're going no-till. So you're using a burn-down herbicide. Usually your no-till herbicide burn-down is going to be based on the size of that horseweed, being sure that you control the horseweed before it gets too large, before it starts bolting. I often get asked, if I'm going out early, what can I use with a residual herbicide to control anything that comes up after that application, that burn-down application? Under the best of situations, under the best, maybe these products might give us 5 weeks of residual control. Whether we use something like Invive or Fierce or you know, any of these, you know, under the best conditions, they're only going to give us about 5 weeks of residual control. Well, if we've got common ragweed out there, that if we go out with our burn down herbicide and use a residual and we're getting about 5 weeks of control, we're going to do a pretty good job helping ourselves out with the common ragweed control, because the bulk of the common ragweed will have germinated while that residual herbicide's still working. The problem is when we get into Palmer amaranth. So by about 5 weeks after that application, Palmer amaranth is starting to, that residual herbicide is starting to peter out. And we're going to need additional herbicide to carry us through the bulk of that germination period of Palmer amaranth. So we need to go out early so we can control our mare's tail, but we don't want to use a lot of our residual herbicides knowing that we're going to have to come back again with a residual herbicide at planting for those soybeans to control this Palmer amaranth. And knowing too that because it continues to germinate, that we're probably going to need to come back in late June with a post-emergence herbicide with more residual that's going to help carry us up through canopy closure. So it's difficult when you have horseweed and Palmer amaranth in the same field to achieve good to excellent control with less than one herbicide application prior to planting your soybeans. Going out early to control the mare's tail, coming back at soybean planting with a residual herbicide to help with the mare's tail, with the Palmer amaranth, is the strategy that we've been going with for consistent control. I don't have time to talk about this, but I do want to mention cover crops. We've been doing a lot of work in the last couple of years on cover crop for weed control, particularly for resistance management. There's been a lot of work in the last 2 to 3 years that's now kind of in this region on cover crops to help with weed control. Obviously, there's been a lot of work on cover crops for nutrient management and other things, but as far as focusing on cover crops for weed control, that's been fairly new. And in the next couple of years, you're going to hear a lot more about cover crops and how we can incorporate them into our strategies to help with resistance management, particularly with these problem species like mare's tail and Palmer amaranth. So with that, you know, with our herbicide resistance that we have in the area, we can achieve good control with all the species that we have, provided that we're using the right product at the right time. And timing is critical. And that we don't allow more than 28 days between our herbicide applications, particularly where we have Palmer amaranth that's going to continue to germinate throughout the summer and grow so quickly. Be cautious about overuse of PPO herbicides or the group 14s, that we don't develop resistance to those products. And give more thought to where we can incorporate some of these non-chemical strategies like cover crops and tillage to help manage some of these resistant species.
Good morning. Thank you, Jenny. I appreciate the opportunity to make a few comments. First of all, I'm Bill Rohr with AgriLab. So AgriLab is an agronomy lab. We don't sell any products. We just provide analytical services primarily for soil, plant tissue, manure, fertilizer, water, and we're doing some food safety testing also. So I just wanted to take the opportunity to talk real briefly about potassium. Potassium in the soil is something, in my opinion, has a tendency to be neglected. Potassium's a little bit different than your nitrogen, your phosphorus, and your sulfur. Does not need to mineralize. So basically what you see in the soil typically is what you get in the plant. And I just want to give you a real quick example of the critical way to evaluate potassium and not ignore the difference between crop removal versus plant uptake. There's a huge difference. We worked with a couple growers this year where we analyzed all of the plant tissue in corn production This particular grower has grown about 300, a little over 300 bushels of corn crop. We analyzed everything to evaluate what's in the plant, what's being removed. It was a huge number for potassium. We're about 350 pounds of K2O is what it was needed just to grow that plant. And we were removing about 100 pounds of K2O. So when we took it to a different level and say, what does that mean from a soil test level? Let me just give you a brief example. It means that that is equivalent to about 150 parts per million of soil test K just to grow the plant. And it was equivalent to a little less than 60 parts per million of soil test K, which was removed. So if you're applying K just according to the removal and not the uptake, make sure you're at a level that will sustain that crop. So again, my take-home message is, if you're growing 300 bushels of corn and your soil test K level is not 150, you're not going to have that soil test K in the soil to grow the plant, regardless of what you're removing with the harvest. So one of many neat things that we learn about agronomy, and that's my factoid for this morning, and have a great day.
John Hall is here. He's representing Maryland Department of Ag and Crop Insurance. So John, you want to say a few things?
I work with our next speaker, so I figured that I better show that I'm actually doing my job. But what happens is the University of Maryland tries to do educational outreach for crop insurance, and we've got some educational materials right there. A lot of times I'll have some information about the law school that Paul works with as well. So I guess the question is if you ever need a contact to get Paul, and you'll hear his expertise next, just let me know and we'll get him over here.
Sponsor. Jen Nelson is here from Chesapeake for our alliance.
Thanks, Jenny. I'm here with the Chesapeake 4R Alliance. We're a collaboration between agribusinesses, agencies, conservation organizations, and researchers. Our goal is to make sure that every nutrient application is consistent with the 4Rs on Delmarva. Just from a quick show of hands, is everybody familiar with the 4R concept? Have you heard of it? Can you name two of the 4Rs? No, okay, so the 4Rs is to make sure that the right nutrient source is applied at the right rate, at the right time, in the right place. So it's my job to know what all 4Rs are. So if our goal is to put out information to identify the practices on Delmarva that are gonna provide the best return on investment for farmers and for the environment on Delmarva, which is a different set of strategies that might work in the Midwest. So we're working toward that end with all those groups that I mentioned earlier. And that's it. If you have any more, if you have any questions about that or would like some more information or a free pen, we have a table in the corner and I'd be happy to talk to you.